Good evening. I'd like to thank each and every one of y'all for joining me this afternoon. We'll give it just a second for people to get notifications and join on if they'd like to. I hope each and every one of y'all had a good week so far. I'd like to just welcome each and every one of y'all to my men's ministry live feed through this week. We each try to do our own ministry throughout the week. Today I'm going to try to, with the Lord's help, bring you a message of the afflictions and trials that we face throughout our lives and how the Lord uses that. So before we get into it, let's all go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Heavenly Father, for the day that you've given us, Father. And just thank you for allowing us, each and every one of us, to be able to share in your word, Lord, and just share in your message. Father, just help each and every one of us to give you reverence and praise you, Father, for the things that you are, Father. Father, help us to seek you for your kingdom and your will, Father, not for what you can do for us. Father, we praise you, Father, for everything that you've done for us. We just pray that you to be with us, Father. And Father, give me the words for this message. In Jesus' name, amen. As we get into the message here, the Lord put this on my heart probably about 6 months ago. I have tried to write it and finish it at least four times, but until this past week, actually these past few days, that it's actually come to fruit in my mind to what I needed to talk about. We're going to try to go through this about afflictions and trials. I'm going to tell you, I guess, a little bit of a story that the Lord put in my mind. It says, as a piece of steel just looks plain and indifferent to the world, but in the hands of a blacksmith, he sees the possibilities of what the steel can become. Now you take this piece of steel right here, to anybody else, other than someone that knows how to work it and how to make it into the things that it could become, pretty much it just looks like a paperweight. To those that don't have the ability or the knowledge to be able to work this, all they see is a small piece of heavy object. But I'm going to show you in the message here the things that a blacksmith does to this steel to make it what it needs to be. With the proper working and grooming, this piece can even become a great work, only when it is wrought in the proper hands. It will certainly not be no easy task to render this steel. It takes time and patience. But it also takes work, stress, and heat to accomplish the process. First off, you have the task of applying the heat to the steel. It is heated until it is red hot and almost to the point that the steel begins to come apart. This is a crucial to the working process because while the steel is first in the fire, its strength and integrity is tested. Through this, the steel's own unique properties begin to show. Also, in the high heat, the unclean and impure materials surface and separate from the steel itself. This gives the worker a better material to work with. After the first heat and purifying of the steel, the piece is then stressed either by striking with a hammer or squeezing with a type of vise or press. This process is required to get the desired shape and function out of the material. The heating and stressing of the work is applied many times until the actual work is wrought to completeness. And by doing so, the product is now a new and stronger creation. The worker is pleased with his creation. So as I was talking there, This piece of steel right here, you would put it in a furnace or an over an open fire, as blacksmiths used to do. You would get it so hot to where it glows red. And as it glows red, all this outside stuff is what is known as mill scale. It begins to fall off. These are impurities that will actually hurt whatever creation you're making out of this when it is complete. If the impurities are not pulled out of this, it will either make it not appealing to the eyes, the creation, and it also make it weaker in how its function is to come. After it is hot and the purifying of it, you have to mold this to whatever you want. It takes great time in molding steel to become whatever you need it to be. You have to press it, hammer it, beat it. It's a great deal of work. But the blacksmith knows what he's doing, and he will complete his work, and in his eyes, the work will be complete and great. Now, let me ask you, is this not the same process that we as Christ's disciples go through? For we are not immune to the tests and trials of this life just because of our faith in Jesus Christ. I'm going to go with you to Jeremiah 18, 1 through 6. This is talking about the potter and the clay. The word which came to Jeremiah and the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. And the vessel he had made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so that he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, O house of Israel, can I not do to you as this potter, says the Lord? Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. And that there speaks right into the message here. I mean, just as the potter had his hand upon the clay, so does the Lord have his hands upon us in this world. Now, as the blacksmith applies fire to the steel to get the impure things from it, so does the Lord apply the fire of tests and trials, so that we may ask of him to forgive our actions and search out our hearts for the impure thoughts or feelings that we let come into our lives. And that is key. You must go to prayer to the Lord, ask him truly to forgive you. And not only forgive you, but ask him to help you to search out your heart for the things that you have let come into your lives. The thoughts and impure thoughts and stuff like that in your lives, that is something that you have to allow to come into your life. That's not something that just automatically appears. You have to be controlling of your mind, your heart. Get thoughts under control. This is a very important thing that we must do, to continue to ask the Holy Spirit to help guide us to search out our heart, to bring forth the impurities in our lives. And James 1 through 4, it says, James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, he writes, greetings, my brethren. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, but let the patience have its perfect work, that ye may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Now, as James wrote that, when we all go through trials, for us to count it as joy, that's sometimes a difficult thing to kind of comprehend. Let's also go to Romans 5, 3 through 5. And it says, as Paul was writing in Romans, And not only that, but we also glory in the tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. New hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who was given to us. Now those words are just as true today as they was when Paul wrote them. And talking about this actually with my wife, she helped me study this a little bit, and we kind of revealed that this is a cycle that we go through. Now, let me try the best of my ability to be able to discuss with you the cycle that this is in Paul's word there. Now, through the scripture, we can see how we as Christ followers, that we are as the steel in the blacksmith's shop. Now, what Paul wrote here in Romans 5 can be seen as a cycle. For as we go through our tribulations or our afflictions, this leads to us having perseverance or endurance, if you will, in our lives. Our patience produces character in ourselves, which leads us having hope or faith in the Lord, which we follow. Now, by this is the reason in which we should glory or rejoice in our afflictions and count it as joy. For if we didn't go through our afflictions that the Lord used to build endurance in our spirit, and with endurance, He instills patience, and with endurance and patience, we then have character built in our lives. After the affliction has come to fruit, we then have our hope and faith strengthened. So now I'm going to ask you, let's all try to rejoice in our afflictions and anticipate the renewing of our hope and faith in the Lord through the trials, because ultimately your afflictions are creating the person God intended you to be. Those that endure will receive. I know that it can be difficult to see our trials as something to rejoice for, but think of it as God's way of showing us how much He cares for us, to build up our character to the person He desires and created us to be for the good works of His kingdom. Now, as this word had come before me, I tried to apply it to my own life and the things that I've gone through. One thing that has probably been one of the greater trials that I faced in my life was losing my brother. He was taken from us unexpectedly through an accident. And it completely wrecked me. We was as close as any two people could ever be. After that, I sought the Lord and didn't really seek Him as I should have. I know I didn't seek Him as I should have. I tried, but every place that I went to, there was people in the churches that reminded me of, I guess, the past. And it was hard for me to go through that. I couldn't really relive the past and the memories that I had, because it broke my heart just to go back and be reminded of the things that we had done at this place or that place. I know now, through that I let the Lord down in that, because I did not seek Him fervently after I lost my brother. Through that, I should have sought his face. I should have let him heal me the way that only he can. I only tell y'all that because through brokenheartedness or hardships or whatever, I honestly hope and pray that each and every one of you all seek the Lord more so through your hardships and afflictions than I did when I was going through mine. Because as a lot of you all know, me and my wife also lost a daughter. And through that hardship, we both ignited a fire back in our lives for the Lord, because we sought the Lord, as I should have the first time when I was put through a trial in this life. And ever since then, we have been continually trying to build our lives more Christ-centered, to be more Christ-like, so that through us, other people that go through afflictions similar that we have gone through, that we may be able to minister to them and show them the correct way to be able to go through trials and afflictions of this life. I honestly want each and every one of you all to seek out your heart, whether you're going through affliction or have been through one before, to ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, show me the things that I have held on to in my heart. Show me what I need to relinquish and give over to you. And Father, give me the strength to be able to relinquish the things that I have let build up in my life. I know that that can be difficult, to see our trials as something to rejoice for. But now I've done read that. I'm sorry. I thank each and every one of you all for being with me and bearing with me through my message. It's been a kind of a tough message on me. I struggle with putting together messages, but after I get it done, I enjoy the word that God put in my heart and the teachings that He teaches me every time I do one of these messages. I encourage each and every one of you to truly get into your word, come up with your own Bible study, or find a Bible study it don't have to be nothing major. I mean, 2 or 3 scriptures a day and just research those scriptures. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, every little bit gets you closer into the word, and closer into the word you get, the closer to the Lord you get. I thank each and every one of y'all. Let's end this in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you now, Father, for the word that you have put upon me, Father. And Father, I pray, Lord, that through me, Father, you have spoken. Father, I pray, Lord, that somebody had got something out of this. Father, I just thank you, Father. Father, for the guidance, for the love, for the chastening, Father. Father, I thank you, Father, for the trials that you put in our lives, Father. Father, for in them trials, those who endure those and those who seek your face, Father, they can rejoice in you, Father. Father, I thank you and I love you. I pray you put your protection upon each and every person, Father, that hears this voice. Father, I pray that you guide them in their ways, Father. Father, and I pray that they would have a heart to seek after you, Father, for in these things, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, I do honestly appreciate each and every one of y'all to listen to this old country boy talk. Y'all have a good night.